agenda, it says approval to sell 30. And I really don't think
you rent or lease a space.
The word sell out of there.
Lease may be more appropriate.
Counselor, do you have any space?
Yeah, I agree. I mean, the agenda is what it is. It was posted with sell, but I think for the record, we could acknowledge we're not selling anything. We would be leasing the individual spaces.
Tim, we'll get what for these spaces?
For the rest of the year, we'll get $75, and then starting in August, we'll get $300 per space.
Any other questions?
And this is on the same basis as the ones we've already offered, is that right?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Be right next door to them.
Same contract. You got a copy of it.
Same lease agreement.
Yep. Do I hear a motion? This is a time since about two. Do I hear a motion from the board?
I'll make a motion that we approve the leasing of 30 additional parking spaces to Lambert High School students at the Old Atlanta Park Recreation Center. Those 30 spaces will be leased remaining this year at $75 for April and May, and then in August, the beginning of the new school year, they will be $300 each, the same as the original 50 spaces, and it is time sensitive.
Second time sensitive. We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carried, 4-0. Mr. Tam being absent. Item 6, no longer bound sewer acquisition. County attorney,
you
finally
going to
get there?
Mr. Chair, members of the board, thank you. We are going to try, and just for the record, there is a draft agreement in your packets, but what we're considering today is the one I just handed out. So if that can just be reflected that what we're actually going to consider is what I handed out. Yes, Mr. Chairman, this is an issue that we've been discussing and postponing for a while now, pertaining to No Longer Bound and their sewer. You may recall when I came and visited with you some months ago, the issue was they had entered into a sewer reservation agreement with the county some years ago. Not only have they not fulfilled all their obligations under that sewer contract, but quite frankly, they need additional capacity to be whole with the county. And you may say, well, how much did they get and how much do they need? They originally purchased 4,000 gallons, and that's on addendum 1 in this packet I've handed out. They need another 2,500 gallons for an aggregate of 6,500 gallons. That's how much my water and sewer department thinks that No Longer Bound needs to be compliant with our regs. And that capacity would be purchased at $15 per gallon. What I'm proposing to do is that we enter into a new sewer reservation agreement with No Longer Bound that, first of all, acts to fulfill all of their obligations under their old agreement. It's called the novation. In other words, it takes that old agreement and basically wipes it off and says, whatever you'd owed, it's now sort of subsumed into this new agreement. So that's the first thing this does. Secondly, it accommodates them paying $97,500 over a term of 10 years. And they would not only enter into an agreement that we would record in the clerk's records of the courthouse, but we would obviously have an agreement with water and sewer as well. And they're gonna pay us 4.5% interest over that 10 years. Now, when we first discussed this, the issue was the interest. I had brought to you a proposal whereby, because they run sort of a drug treatment center on their property, that they would basically allocate a certain number of slots for individuals perhaps in the county court system or with the sheriff's office that could then have, you know, go through that system and be treated for drug dependency. We reached out to the judiciary and to the sheriff's office, and although I didn't hear anything negative at all about the program, I just couldn't get comfortable that it was enough of a direct value that I could sort of assign to it an interest abatement measure. I just didn't. I've talked with them repeatedly. So what I'm proposing to do is take the whole notion of waiving their interest altogether in lieu of the dedicated spaces in the program. And let's go ahead and do assess them interest, and we'll just tack it on to the back of their payment program. So the way it would work is they would owe us $97,500. They would pay that to us in 10 years of payments, $812.50 per month. And then they're gonna owe us an additional $23,756.94 in accumulated interest that they will pay us over 36 months at $659.92. So in other words, they'll pay their principal, and then they'll pay their interest on the back end, and that should make us completely whole. To be fair, I have not addressed this yet with No Longer Bound. They may think I'm going on this whole notion of interest abatement based upon dedicated slots in their program, but I know that there was a board interest in just getting this done. It's been on the agenda too many times, needs to get moving. So this is what I'm proposing. If you all approve it, I will take it back to Mike Carter and the folks at No Longer Bound and see if they will agree to it.
If it's folks that are running through our system,
yes,
and they're holding slots open to run through our system,
yes,
is drug seizure money from the sheriff's office allowed to be used for this?
Commissioner Levent, I'm trying to think of my drug seizure memorandum that I wrote some time ago, and whether this sort of thing would be legitimate. I don't know that it would be, because I think drug seizure funds typically have to be used for a dedicated law enforcement purpose, and I don't know that drug dependency counseling or therapy would fall within that category.
And also, it'll be up to the sheriff too, but we couldn't decide that.
No, I know that. It's just something that would just be an option. You're leaving a lot tacked on the back, but yet they're leaving slots open for our system.
Well, we give a discount on sewer. I mean, we don't, as Ken said, we can't put a money value on the slots that they open.
I know that.
He was just challenging for me. I know y'all wanted to.
But if he hasn't run it by the people No Longer Bound, maybe they have an idea of what they feel that is for all those slots.
But they haven't been at all cooperative.
No.
Their lack of cooperation, I think, tells the whole story here.
And what happens if they don't pay?
If they don't pay, we would give our remedies under the promissory note, and we could discontinue service.
They have tons of funding. We should see their financial sheet.
I mean, this needs to happen. Some sort of a memorialization needs to occur, whatever the deal is. This is the best deal I can come up with. I mean, this is an accommodation to them anyway. We don't typically do this sort of thing, but we're trying. I mean, we understand they provide a general service to the citizens of our county. We all get that.
Exactly.
So we're trying to lean forward and do something decent for them, but this is the best I got that's consistent with the two of
us.
I get all that.
Is this time sensitive?
And now, you know what, Commissioner, that's a great question. I don't need it time sensitive because, quite frankly, if you all approve it, it'll go consent. In the meantime, that allows me to go out to them and let them see if they want to approve it.
Seems very fair, Counselor.
Thank you.
Any more discussion?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that we approve the agreement between Forsyth County and No Longer Bound related to sewer acquisition and a payment schedule as provided to us just now and described by the county attorney.
All right, Counselor.
That is perfect. Thank you.
Mr. Chair, second.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Carries 4-0 for approval. Commissioner Tam. Item 7, donation of parcels in Greenleaf Cemetery.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this is a recent, just petition that came to the county informally. Both the county manager and I have reviewed it and obviously thought it appropriate for the Board of Commissioners to consider it. But it is basically an offer to donate to the county two parcels in the Greenleaf subdivision. I encourage you to look toward the back of the packet under Agenda Item 7. You should see a color map of Greenleaf subdivision. We all know that's the distressed subdivision that's in various stages of deterioration that has been the subject of some board action previously. I believe this is an entity, perhaps a lender, that is just trying to get this off the books and wants to know if the county would like to receive a donation. Do you see the purple squares around the two parcels? That's the parcels that they are proposing to be donated to the county. The only thing I would offer to you is I'm not sure what the utility would be for the county to accept this donation, except it takes it off our tax rolls, and I don't know what we would do with it.
And it has houses on it.
They're houses, but they're not habitable.
Why would we want to do that?
Well, I mean, what could we do? Can we sell land in the future, Counselor?
It'd be difficult because, you know, unless we got all of this land donated to us at once. Now, that would be different. If that's the case, we might open a park or make it, you know, green space or what have you. But just to get a couple of locked off parcels, all that
don't even connect.
It just makes their problem our problem.
I think before we go much further, I think our tax commissioner has a problem with this, so we can combine these two and talk about them. I think a lot of taxes have been paid.
You might want to, you know, Mr. Ledbetter has come to me a couple of times and said there are folks that keep making inquiries about Greenleaf, and it looks to me there's a lot of like disparate groups that don't know each other are all trying to say, what can we do? If anything, the county might be able to facilitate bringing them together to try to figure this out.
Get our taxes paid, right? Maybe take over these two. We don't really,
It needs to be done at all at once, obviously, but there also needs to be some amount of funds given back to the county to, if all the houses have to go down and be removed, then that should not be our expense.
Oh, no.
Our position.
Right.
Yeah, our position historically has been this property is going to have to be replatted. They're going to have to all be taken down. And remember, this was a community septic system development, which we don't even allow anymore.
No sewer.
So there's no sewer, so it's going to have to be septic systems. It's challenging topography for septic just because of the grades on the property. So
could we perhaps postpone this and get to Matthew? Maybe you get to him and kind of still take something we can get the subdivision demolished and off our books and get it looking better.
Yes, sir.
Is it in mine? Yeah, I know where it is. I thought that was now in your district. What's the main road in front of it? It's Wallace Tatum. It's off of the golf course. Isn't it off Burnt Ridge?
No, okay. This is one off P Ridge. Is it P Ridge?
I think it is.
Yes, P Ridge.
Oh, it is. I thought Greenleaf was down. I thought it was on that Burnt Ridge road.
No, I mean, the answer is yes, but we'd have to go just off title records and who owns it. I'm willing to do that.
At least send a letter.
No, ask Matt who's been talking to him.
Yeah, Matt wants to, they could be up for tax sale. Somebody wants to buy them all. It may be the easiest way to do it, and with the knowledge, they're going to have to tear these houses down and start over again.
So there's no people living in these now?
No, they don't have any sewer, any water.
There's no employees.
So basically, they'd have to start making lots large enough that would perk.
What happens if you don't follow the UDC and then?
Well, these guys didn't follow anything. They just built houses with no permits. Sold them on the internet, didn't they?
So just hypothetically, let me ask you a question. Somebody did end up buying all of this out. Would it possibly work if they demoed? Take three, demo two, you've got one. Does that leave enough land for somebody possibly to put septic in?
Absolutely.
So that kind of sort of way, I mean, that's it. That's very interesting.
You can expect that if a white knight developer comes in and want to take this over, demo it, and make it productive, you can anticipate they may come to you and say, work with them on platting and maybe even a density, a new zoning to figure out how to make it.
We had one individual want to do it Habitat for Humanity, but it didn't work out.
That's correct.
You'd have to take out certain homes.
You got to take out those homes. They're yet to demolish every home out there.
So they're not built correctly.
Oh, no, they're not sheetrock.
Opened up.
Busted windows. Busted doors.
Mr. Chairman, does the board want to take any action on the proposal to donate and reject the donation? I mean, that wouldn't take away me going to get with Matt Ledbetter, but I do feel like I owe this gentleman a response.
Can we just put it off till you talk to Matt Ledbetter? Make a motion.
What's the odds of you doing anything with this guy?
There's a lot of people talking to Matt about
that. Okay. Yeah. All right.
I mean, I don't see the county taking it.
Postpone for 30?
Yeah. April 23rd,
Todd? That's good. I'll make a motion we postpone this item to April 23rd,
second.
2013.
I have a motion postponed to April 23rd. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? 4-0. Mr. Tam, be that one. Item 8, update of competition.
What I'm handing out to you is just one piece of paper to add into your agenda book. And it's got the section numbers we'll be talking about where I've made an amendment.
I mean, could you do a smaller font?
Yeah, well, I want you to make sure you got your reading glasses on.
I just asked him if he could do a smaller font.
All
right,
now.
You got this board getting older. Yeah, we just gave you it for right now. You can't give it back to us.
You all asked me some time ago, or we had talked in this chamber about modifying our local legislation by way of home rule. You know, under the Georgia Constitution, we have the ability to modify those local enactments to affect our governing authority. locally. We don't have to go down to the local delegation or the General Assembly to do that. Well, the first thing we did was we dusted off the Muni Code. And one of the things we have found out is that the Muni Code is not capturing entirely even our enabling legislation as it exists right now. And so we've got some housekeeping to do with the Muni Code to make sure they're showing the right stuff. And then with respect to what is our law, I still recommend we've got some changes to do. So if you turn in your packet and open up to that first page, I hope you see a bunch of red language that's sort of crossed out, and you might see like a green highlighted block about three quarters of the way down. First of all, let me tell you what you're looking at. You're looking at what is in Muni Code right now. So the first paragraph you see there that's redlined through, there is created in and for the county, Forsyth County Board of Commissioners. That's what's in Muni Code right now, and that is actually not correct. That is not in Muni Code. That is, in fact, legislation that was adopted some years ago, I believe in 2001, that had to be ratified by the voters, and never was. Somehow it's made its way in Muni Code. So that needs to come out, and it needs to be replaced with that section you see in all green bolded, that paragraph there is hereby created. That's actually the correct language. So again, I'm not asking you to do anything on that. I'm just pointing out to you, we've got to get with Muni Code and make sure they are reflecting online the correct verbiage from our local or enabling legislation. So go to the next page, you'll see again just blocks of all that red line. That's just information that's actually inappropriately in the All right, if you go like to the fourth page, you may see about halfway through the page, you see another section of green beginning now. That's language, again, that should be in Muni Code, that's not. So we're gonna get with Muni Code and make sure they put that in there as well. And that is, in fact, the language dealing with post-voting. That's not in there right now, but we all know, pursuant to local changes in our law, we are a post-voting jurisdiction now, so that's gotta be put back in the Muni Code. So just keep flipping through the green. And hopefully you'll get to section three. Hope to see county manager qualifications and bond after all that pages and pages of green. That's in section three. All right, so we got a section on the county manager, and you ought to see in that paragraph a couple things. First of all, you'll see some text redlined. It starts with the words, before entering upon his duties, we recommend your local law be changed to take that out. First of all, county manager is already covered by the basically the blanket bond by ACCG. He doesn't need a particular section identifying a $3,000 bond. Quite frankly, he needs to be under our blanket bond. And so that language needs to come out. Interestingly, you also see in that paragraph references to county manager. County manager, the local law was really never changed away from county administrator. I think Muni Code just went and ran with that to make it county manager. Just for purposes of housekeeping, we believe we ought to go ahead and adopt to make it county manager and our local law. So we will bring that back to you at another time. I mean, I'm not really going to be asking for much after the end of the presentation, except just to let you know where I'm going and why. Going down to section five on that same page, you ought to see it's a paragraph called bond. And it's talking about the members of the board before entering upon the duty shall give a bond to be signed by a surety company. The recommendation is just to add a sentence that the cost of that bond shall be paid by Forsyth County. Okay. We are recommending that be added. You'll turn to the next page on salary. This pertains to salary of the board of commissioners. This language was wrong as well. Historically, it's sort of difficult to articulate, but our local legislation was modified by the General Assembly back in 2004. They did it to take advantage of a statutory section that for the first time allowed local governments like us to change our salary completely by local law. You remember this? You may not remember it, but we pass a resolution changing the board member's salary, then remember you have to wait an election, and then it becomes effective the first January after the election, by which the citizens have got to come out and presumably decide whether you did good or bad changing your salary, right? Well, that whole section, if you see the sidebar there next to section seven, you ought to see a sidebar that's got A, B on it, and it says the salary, compensation, expenses, and expenses in the nature of compensation. That is the current local law in Forsyth County pertaining to salary under Section 7. Never made it in to the Muni Code. So we got to change that and put that in there, and I'll bring that back to you in a format where that's in there. But I just wanted you to know that, and I'll take care of it. Obviously, as part of this local law modification, I'm not suggesting that you all change your salary. I'm simply recommending that we get the local law correctly that is actually, you know, that's been adopted by the General Assembly. Going to Section 8 under regular meetings. Again, this section in Muni Code is correct, but there's language in the existing law that says that a meeting may be called by the chairman and by the other four members of the board. I don't know what that means. I don't know whether that means that each board member individually can call for a meeting, or the four of them have to get together and call for a meeting. It's unclear to me. So my recommendation is that it shall be called pursuant to the rules and procedures adopted by this board on a year-to-year basis, which is what you all do every January. Going to Section 11, the clerk. This is where I just handed out an additional page because I wanted to show a tweak from what was actually in the book. So look at your little handed out page very quickly here. The board is hereby empowered and authorized to employ and engage the services of a clerk. The salary of said clerk shall be, remember right now it's $2,400 per year with a maximum of $4,200 per year. Ms. Bush and Ms. Henderson may have a concern with that. The salary of the clerk shall be established pursuant to the Forsyth County personnel policies and otherwise at the discretion of the board. That would be my recommendation. That's what needs to be changed. Going on, if we can, to Section 12 under powers, you'll see that we recommend that you strike, you'll see the stricken language, the superintendent of public schools. That is a separate sovereign entity from the Board of Commissioners. We don't need to really have any regulation over the superintendent of public schools, so I'm recommending under our powers, we strike that. You'll see there at the bottom as well, that the Board of Commissioners is authorized to promulgate policies regarding minor officers or employees of the county. Such policies shall set forth rules and regulations regarding suspension and termination. The old language, folks, anticipates things such as guard camps, public work camps, janitors, county positions, and other things that simply are just outdated. We just don't have them anymore. So I'm recommending that be Section 12.1 under police powers. This language is all appropriately in our local laws, but I am making some recommendations to you. This section is really not consistent with the state of Georgia regular law anymore. I would like it to reflect that we have to hold actual public hearings before we adopt ordinances. Our local law doesn't even make us hold public hearings. It just has something called a reading. And quite frankly, what a reading is not a public hearing, and I think it's important that we make sure that we go out and actually have public input on the laws that we adopt. So I'm recommending that modification be inserted. Also, it provides in our local law now that we have the ability to create misdemeanors. I don't believe that the county boards of commissioners have the ability to create misdemeanors. Only the General Assembly can do that. So we need to make sure it's consistent with the general law pertaining to ordinances. We create ordinance violations. We don't create misdemeanors. Section 13 pertaining to audits. There is an extensive local enactment in our code right now about audits. The audits are carefully controlled by Georgia law and also by generally accepted accounting standards. So Mr. Gruen doesn't need our local law to tell him what audits are required. We already have state law audit requirements, and my recommendation is we default to those. Hope y'all get what's happening here. A lot of this is just cleaning up. A lot of this is house cleaning. Some of it's substantive, some not. If you turn to the next page, you ought to see some green bolded, and then you'll see some green-red, which almost has like a little bit of a Christmas theme. That was not on purpose, by the way, but it's green and red. That pertaining to our purchasing policies. Our purchasing policies were actually changed in our local laws in 2007 to basically say that the county has the right to promulgate purchasing policies, and whatever purchasing policies we implement are what's going to control. That change never got into Muni Code. So Muni Code was incorrect on that. We need to go back to making Muni Code reflect that our purchasing policies promulgated and adopted by the Board of Commissioners control. Going on to section 16 under contracts. It says, it shall be unlawful for the board to enter into any contracts involving services or property with any person or persons related to any member of the board by blood or marriage, as a spouse, child, parent, brother, or sister, or with any business entity in which a member of the board has an interest, except consistent with the disclosure and abstention provision set forth in the Forsyth County Code. I raise this to you because I just want to make sure that our local laws embrace our ethics ordinance, which we have, and I know the board has spent a lot of time on the ethics code. You would like to make sure that those two are perfectly in alignment. Section 18 pertaining to financial statements. Once again, I'm just asking for the local law to reflect the state of the law with respect to financial statements and audits as it exists, set by the General Assembly, not by our local law. So that's why I'm recommending modifications there. Section 19, with respect to the chairman, this is the language that provided that the chairman must hold a full office hours or a full day of office hours each week. I don't think that's practical, and I don't think that's the way it's customarily done, so I'm just asking that the local law be changed, that the chairman will hold office hours as are reasonably necessary to perform his duties.
Because
one day? I like that. I just have to see you one day.
Yeah, well, no, you have to have office hours one regular day of each week, and you have to remain in the building that full day.
Can we go lunch?
No, sir. Section 21.
Yes, I'm fine for lunch at 2:15 minute break, sir.
Contact with state and federal agencies. This language anticipates that we were going to be in constant contact with the director of the Bureau of Public Roads and the United States Department of Commerce. I'm sure that made sense years and years and years ago when it was adopted, but it makes less sense now. So I'm recommending that that be changed to we'll keep in contact with GDOT and the FHA as much as necessary. And then I'm recommending some language with respect to the effective date. So that's it. That's all there is. And I just wanted to go over that with you. The next time, unless you tell me and give me other direction, the next time you will see this is when it is actually in resolution format. And we have to have two public sort of votes on this. They have to be back-to-back within like 60 days of one another before this can be effective, and then I have to file it with the Secretary of State.
What made us look at this now? Did the state come to us and say?
I just think that every once in a while it's helpful to dust these things off and take a look at them.
I think he stays up at night and dreams about these things. So. What it can change.
I just wondered what prompted. It just seems to be rather outdated.
Extra value that I have. like to think about these things. No, I just, you know, it's just helpful to look at this, and obviously this probably hasn't been updated in this sort of comprehensive way in decades.
Right.
Do we need a motion on this anyway?
No, sir. I think the board's already given me direction. This is just going over with you.
Any other questions from the board? On item 9, County Attorney, IGA.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this last issue is a proposed IGA between Forsyth County and the City of Cumming, and it is related, quite frankly, to the you know, significant infrastructure projects we are doing downtown right now. All of these moving parts are all sort of working together with respect to the jail and the courthouse, and quite frankly, remember we went from an original plan where we were going to have a parking deck literally on the back of our courthouse to where, in order to open up more green space and to make it look more aesthetically pleasing, we decided to pull that courthouse back, and I think we called it the town green concept, to put more open space. Well, then we had to get a little more creative with our parking. And so what I'm bringing to you is an IGA with the City of Cumming, or a proposed IGA with the City of Cumming, that answers some of the questions about where that parking is going to go and some efforts that the county is going to have to undertake to make that happen. So let me sort of walk you through it. You see in the couple of pages some whereas clauses. You can read those if you want to, but that's not really the moving parts of the contract. It really starts on paragraph 1, the Pilgrim Square condemnation land acquisition. We will actually be, unless we can resolve an amicably with the property owner, we will be actually condemning, entering into litigation with the owner of the property that is just, I guess, just to the east of us right now. I believe that's east, on the border of Pilgrim Mill Road. next to where Classics Restaurant used to be, just immediately adjacent to that parcel. And it had been back and forth as to who would take the lead with respect to the land acquisition for that. The county, it looks like, will be taking the lead on the acquisition of that. We need the parcel for a parking deck. We already own, obviously, the Classics site, which is where county folks are parking right now. But as part of this reconfiguration of the parking facilities, we need that additional space. And so with the city's, I guess you'd say, blessing, we will be condemning that parcel, assuming that we're not able to work out an amicable acquisition with the property owner. And those efforts are ongoing already, by the way, with respect to the property owner, but we don't have that addressed yet. Also, forgive me, I should have done this before, and that was my fault. I want to hand out this color map, because this may provide you a little bit of further guidance. If you look on the color map I just handed out, or it's being handed out now, toward the upper part of that map, you'll see a red block that says proposed parking deck, 430 to 480 spaces. Okay, and you'll see that it blanches over into what I'm calling this Pilgrim Square parcel. That's why we will need to condemn. So, going back to the first part of the IGA, this IGA basically says that the county will take the lead on land acquisition, and the City of Cumming will interpose no objection with the county condemning land within the City of Cumming. They will provide also reasonable assistance as is needed. Right. Paragraph 2 is for a public parking facility. This provides that within 30 days of the final approval of this IGA by both parties, and I think it is important at this point to let you know that the City of Cumming has already approved this version of the IGA. They've already approved this at a regularly called council meeting, is my understanding. Within 30 days, if we were to approve this, the city will pay to the county $5.3 million of SPLOS 6 funds. That, as far as the City of Cumming goes, those funds were dedicated for the construction of a downtown parking facility. In other words, the City of Cumming has limited, what I would call limited use or limited purpose funds that have to be used a certain way. They are basically saying, county, you have a need to build parking decks, so we will take money that we otherwise need to use to build a parking deck, and we will give it to you for you to use in your parking deck acquisition, construction, efforts. So they would pay us that $5.3 million. In addition to the $5.3 million, the city would then provide to us whatever their collections are for the balance of basically SPLOS 6. And as you know, SPLOS 6 runs until, I believe, June 30th of this year. So they would basically be giving us the balance of their SPLOS receipts. But they want, in exchange for giving us the balance of their SPLOS receipts to use for parking deck purposes, they would want us then to reciprocally, on a dollar-for-dollar basis, give them an equal amount of park and green space bond funds that they then want to spend on park and recreation city improvements on city park infrastructure. Everybody understand what would happen there? Not 5.3 million. I'm talking about the remainder of their collections from probably the date they pay us the 5.3 million, whatever else they get in SPLOS, they'll pay that to us. We then pay them an equivalent amount in park and green space bond funds.
And we can't be exact on knowing what that would be, but we guess around 500,000
The information I've heard is about $500,000.
$500,000. I think it's not quite that much.
No, I think when we first talked with them, they were thinking 5.6 to 5.7. At that time, I think they had 5.1 in that fund. I think at this point we're looking at maybe $100,000 a month. So whenever this is executed, anything over the 5.3 between that and the end of June, perhaps a couple thousand, $100,000.
Okay. Could be as low as $300,000.
Yeah, could be.
Yeah, could be. This gives a certain amount to us.
Right.
The county will then use that $5.3 million the city will give us for the acquisition of property, the design, construction, and related street improvements and equipping of two parking facilities. Now, here I got to go back to your map. We know we have one up in the northern quadrant. that will actually go onto that Pilgrim Square property and literally will be adjacent to the building we're in now. But in the lower left-hand quadrant, you can also see a parking facility, what we're calling the Castleberry parking facility that is on the old Tyson's parking lot. So that is the second parking facility that we would then be authorized to use that money on.
But we would not be having to use the money to acquire the property on Castleberry.
That's correct. We don't have to acquire that property because the city will agree that we can lease and have full access to the bottom half. In other words, basically the construction footprint. We'll have a lease on that property while we are building that parking deck, and then after we finish building, once it's substantially completed, the lease expires and it reverts back to the city property.
Okay. But they leave it open to the public to use, I assume.
The completed parking deck itself, if this IGA is adopted, has to be a public parking facility that is equally accessible by residents and citizens, well, of anybody, but the city and the county, at a minimum.
But at special events, they can charge for parking?
At special events, they can charge for parking. On an equal basis to everyone.
But they will leave county, because county cars there, they will not charge county cars or county employees to park.
I don't think it spells that out in the agreement. It does call out government vehicles, but it doesn't call out POVs, personal owned vehicles. It might have to report at 7 in the evening to park there and walk across to, let's say, the jail, the new jail. So it doesn't call that out. It's something that you might want to consider having them call out in the contract if you thought that was important.
It sounds reasonable.
Let me keep going because I want to tell you just a couple of elements of this. We in the agreement call this what we're calling the Castleberry parking facility, and then we call it the Mason Street parking facility. And we call those in the agreement the combined facilities. They will be our projects. So even though one of them is going to be on city ground with a lease to us, that's going to be the Castleberry parcel. These will be county construction projects, and the city will agree to cooperate with us on permitting, inspections, etc. Upon final completion of the Castleberry facility, we will issue any documents necessary to vest title to that facility to the City of Cumming, subject to these requirements. Number one, that facility must remain open and in good condition to be used for public parking. Number two, the facility shall be operated by the city for the benefit and equal access of all the citizens of the city and county. Number three, the city and county agree and acknowledge this facility may need to be expanded in the future, and both parties will work together in good faith to accommodate that expansion. Number four, the facility must be open for vehicular use and access to the public from at least 7 a.m. to 5 p.m. Monday through Friday. And as the county manager alluded to, no Forsyth County government vehicle will be charged for overnight parking. And number five, as he also alluded to, the facility is free to the public during business hours. However, the city maintains the right to upgrade for special event if they overlap with business hours. And I think the natural thing we all think about is possibly the fair is one in which they
can you add on number four, now under county vehicles, that also county employees are coming to work using the personal vehicles are also allowed to park there?
You know, that's, Commissioner Levent, I will say this to you right now. We're free to discuss and talk about additions all that we want to, and I'll make a note of that. Just be mindful that since the City of Cumming has already approved one, if we make changes to it, we have to take it back to them and they have to approve it again. So I don't mean to get in your way. I will write that on there, but I just want to make sure you're aware of that.
I just hate them, see them showing up a few times a year and they're trying to charge them to park. Although they can always use ours and walk an extra block. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Are you going to address Bonnie Street that far? Page 4?
No.
Yeah, same thing.
Southwest corner.
Oh, as far as where it's located?
That's.
Yeah, that. Thank you for that. Just want to make you aware as well, because this was something that had been discussed among staff and perhaps some on the board, is where on that Tyson property this parking facility would go. And under this version of the IGA, just want you to be mindful it's going to be on the southwest corner of that parcel. So it's going to be the footprint and location of the footprint will be decided by this IGA. We had originally talked about maybe some discretion with the county and city sort of working together to figure out where we wanted it positioned exactly on there. It's going to be locked in.
Well, I think it's a long run, but that's something we discussed. I think southwest corner presents a problem, literally by way of states, the southwest corner. We need to look at it as our architect needs to approve the spot or something. It's going to be hard to fit in those things.
It is. I had a meeting in Alpharetta this morning with the some of the project team leaders, the architects, and the construction manager and program manager, and we've talked about this several times. And in fact, if we're the way that the parking deck is designed today, the both the height and the size of it, or the size of it, it allows for it's basically laid out what you the way you see it today in this document in this aerial. We talked about moving that to the southwest corner, and in fact, in order to get proper access, ingress, egress, and emergency vehicle access around the garage, it's going to be almost impossible to fit it onto or into the southwest corner of that parcel.
I really think the mayor was not being so specific, but he didn't want it up above that corner, but his language made it specific.
Yeah.
It's something we...
It did. It locked us into that corner, and I've got drawings here. We went over today and looked at different options, and it's unless it's a much, much, much smaller parking facility, it won't fit in the southwest corner and give you that access you need.
Let me ask you quick, Counselor, if we change the language in this IGA, can we make it so that if they approve our language, it's approved without coming back to us, we make minor changes?
Absolutely. I mean, if we make changes, this can simply be, and I hate to, you know, it's not an adversarial proceeding, but that would be, this is our offer.
Yeah.
And then if they approve it, it's done.
It's done, yeah. So it doesn't have to come back to us.
No, sir.
And these are minor changes, but I think it's for the betterment of the parking deck, to be able to put it where our architect says it's the best location.
It is. And if we can just have the flexibility or latitude to work with the city on where it's placed, we're willing to do that. The issue is if they lock it down to that southwest corner. That's going to be a challenge.
I think he just meant not in the front, but
okay.
I think that's more than we do need to get worked out.
Okay.
Ken, on the property C-16-041, if I understood you correctly, it looks like we will be condemning that if this agreement is agreed to.
Yes, sir.
I'm trying to see if there's a way to get some feel for what that might cost when it's condemned. Because right now, you know, looking at this, it's sort of like, in terms of dollars, the city's what, given us $500,000?
5.3.
1.3, really.
1.3 million.
Yeah.
No extra over and above.
Yeah, extra over and
above. Okay, so if, you know, if that land is somehow in that ballpark, you know, that's one thing. If that's a $20 million piece of property, that's another thing.
I'm trying to think how to best say that.
Don't we have in the budget, though, some money for parking?
We in the, not the parking, but in SPLOSH, we do have some money to condemn that building.
You have $1 million in SPLOSH 7 for to use toward expansion, if you will, improvement of the admin building in its area.
And then we'll have one point whatever left of when we, if we do this swap with the city.
Well, actually all that 5.3 will go into, we won't separate it.
No, well, we can't commingle the funds. The 5.3 will go into a fund that Dave Gruen tells us to put it in, and any additional funds will go in that same fund. Those funds will, and Ken, check me on this, all of those funds will need to go toward the parking facilities or improvements to the parking facilities or areas around the facilities.
Landscaping and things like that.
Okay.
Commissioner Boff, I can tell you this, that we have been in negotiations with the property owner, informal, you know, we've not filed a petition yet, but at least from an appraisal standpoint, that doesn't mean what they will
what they will demand from us, but from an appraisal standpoint, it's much closer to the first figure that you mentioned as opposed to the $20 million.
Which if you're 1.3 plus the 1 million, you should be within your window easily.
Right. Now, on the C-16087, if we build that, it's on somebody else's property.
That is correct.
And after 50 years or so, I don't know what the period of time, that building is also no longer ours.
It's not even 50 years. It's going to be, we will basically convey whatever documents we need to convey ownership of that facility to the city at the time that it is substantially completed for them to operate pursuant to these obligations.
It will always be a public parking facility.
We have one of those.
Always is a long time.
But that's why they're giving the money up, because they have an obligation to build a parking deck. We have an horse box to build a parking deck. And you're ultimately just joining forces and you're building two parking decks.
Yeah, well.
And in return, they're giving you the land for free here at Tyson to use, and they're dedicating Mason Street for us to use up here.
Yeah. Two things. The asset of the second parking lot will go to whom?
The asset of the second parking lot will be on the city's books, be subject to, David, I assume, city depreciation schedules. As a city asset, they'll be responsible for city maintenance and repair.
As stated here.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if something happens to it, if they have a crack or something, somebody runs into it, they have to repair it, not us.
Okay.
Kind of like the aquatic center. It's all theirs.
To the degree there is liability of an accident of some kind, who will have the liability? We'll have the liability, I assume, for one over right here.
Right.
And we'll have the liability of that building.
During the construction process, this is going to be county construction. It'll be ours. Yeah. It would be our lot. We have dominion and control over the site. After it's conveyed to the city, if there is, a robbery or something, or some allegation that you're not keeping the site free, you know, safe, reasonably safe, or there's an accident due to negligence in the configuration of it, that'll be the city's.
And then finally, the money that the city's going to use for their parks, I don't think it specifies what it is they're going to do, does it?
It does not. What it says is that it will be used for, forgive me, it will be used for city park and recreational facilities. Now this is a distinction. Under paragraph 3, where it says funding of upgrades to city park in all bold, all caps, that is very clear that the $4 million that they will receive from the county must be used for fiscal infrastructure improvements, a new pool, a new jungle gym, a new tennis court, what have you.
Office building.
Offices.
But the change where they wanted the dollar-for-dollar give back, remember that, where they we collect the rest of SPLOST funds and then turn them back and give them a dollar-for-dollar, that is not really nailed down on how they can spend that, except it does say city's park and recreational facilities. The position I will take with the city, if we adopt this version, is it has to be used for physical upgrades just like the other money does. Because remember, that's from our perspective. If they're insisting we pay them park and rec bond funds, there are some strings attached to how that money gets spent. Okay.
On a day in, day out basis, not thinking of the fair and other special events, Doug, do you expect county employees, generally speaking, to park at the
Castle Bray lot?
Yeah.
Not a great deal of vehicles. I think the majority of county employees will park at the Mason Street lot. Once the jail is built, there may be some jail employees that park at that parking deck at the Castleberry lot. I think it might be a little closer for them. The other component of that is, if in design of the new jail there is limited surface parking at the jail, then you will probably have some employees customers that may come to the jail use that parking facility as well. So we haven't nailed that number down, but I suspect there will be some employees that park at that deck.
But not, okay. not a great deal.
Not a great deal, I think.
But yeah, my concern is if you leave it where it is on the map and somebody else builds, let's say, a really nice mall where you see all the cars right now.
Right.
And the mall is very, very attractive, then this parking lot will fill up with people parking to go to the mall or whatever the other attraction is. And I just want to make sure that, you know, we're talking about a long time here, that this will nevertheless, as best we can see, it fulfill our needs even in the future.
Well, that's a little bit difficult to project. I do know that the design of this facility and the Mason Street facility is designed such that, that it can be expanded vertically.
Okay. And it did say that if we need additional parking, that City and County will work together. Okay. We're not responsible for making it bigger ourselves.
Okay.
The distance, the two are almost identical to the jail.
They are.
And where it'll be located from the street level here.
Yeah. Any other things?
No, sure. Just go through the remaining obligations. Just, we made it basically to the upgrade of the city parks, and I think I walked you through the fact they will use that $4 million we will deliver to the city for infrastructure upgrades. Have to be completed with those within 24 months. Those will be city projects, not our projects, and they will have an obligation to keep those parks open for city and county residents. Some additional sort of what I would call wrap-up obligations under this IGA. Number one pertains to Mason Street. Of course, Mason Street is the street immediately out the window here. It is contemplated that the city will agree to abandon Mason Street. You look on that map I gave you, you see two points on Mason Street called A and B. They will have actually abandoned that section of Mason Street, which will of course then becomes the property of those who own the fee interest on both sides of Mason Street, which happens to be, well, us. So therefore we would own Mason Street, and therefore we'll have the ability to put our parking deck right on top of it. So Mason Street, at least that section of it, would be closed. School Street improvement, you know, School Street is, of course, intersects with Mason Street here directly behind us. The county will agree, as part of our construction of the parking deck, we will also agree to upgrade School Street from what it basically now is a one-way, although I think it may have some two-way access, at least it divides like halfway, it becomes one-way. It'll now be a two-way thoroughfare, is what it'll be, from Dahlonega Highway to Pilgrim Mill. And we will pay for that, and we will also put a sidewalk on the southern border of School Street.
Which just seems reasonable, because we have to do that anyways to help us first.
And
people
we will
leave in the parking deck.
And we will be able to use the city's $5.3 million for that. That is an ancillary part of our parking deck construction, is to provide access back there.
We will need that.
Yeah, we will need that.
With respect to the unabandoned section of Mason Street, which is right here, connecting to, I guess this is State Route 20, I suppose. They've agreed that we're going to have to widen that to make, because that's going to be the main entrance to our parking deck. They've agreed to donate us any necessary temporary construction easements, and in fact, any permanent construction easements or permanent easements needed by that improvement.
That's for deceleration when coming in?
No, actually, here.
That's the entrance.
And then there's one other section that we will just agree in good faith to consider perhaps providing an access to our parking deck off of School Street. As I mentioned, our main access will be here on Mason Street going in. If the county manager can see the design works the way he needs it to, he might think about putting an entrance off of School Street as well, but that's aspirational language, not me. That's the proposal with this IGA. As I mentioned to the chairman, if we put in tweaks to it, we can approve the IGA with those tweaks now, send it to the city and say, if you approve this, we have a deal.
And just to be perfectly clear, when we went with the green plan, as you stated on the building,
yes,
we lost that parking option. The only other option that is readily before us, if we didn't go this route and we didn't do a parking over on Castleberry, would be to do an enormous parking deck here that would, in the architect's opinion, not be very appealing for it to be bigger than our buildings in order to compensate for our own employees and the public.
Small footprint would be a lot taller.
Yeah. detrimental to the, even if we put 700 cars in there one day and tried to get them out, it'd be gridlock in here.
So it is, I mean, in all fairness, we're not loaded with a lot of options as far as parking goes.
That's correct.
Okay.
I think this is a great option, just trying to build parking lots out. It works well. So, Council, could we tweet it just a little bit? Council Commissioner Levent, you want to add that POV?
No, if it's not necessary, it's not necessary. I mean, if y'all think it is, I just hate to see those few weeks a year the employees get stuck with that.
But I don't think it's an issue enough to try to make it
to
change, because we've got this parking deck here.
Yeah, I agree. It's just as close.
The only thing I do need, we do need to nail down the southwest corner, as Doug said. Doug, how would you like that to read?
Well, one of the things I'm not sure of is I do know that the city would like to maintain this portion of the parking area for future development. I get that, I understand it, we've talked about that. What I don't understand is if they want to lock this down to the southwest corner, is their desire on their part to actually to free up this frontage on Castleberry as well. If that is their desire, then it might be a good idea for me to sit down with the mayor and determine what his goal is. If it's simply there was a mistake in the language, or in fact earlier in the document they mentioned the southwest corner of this intersection, and that's what they meant for the section here that says the facility must be placed in the southwest corner of that particular parcel, maybe there was some confusion there, and I would like to clear that up. Otherwise, again, I've got a drawing here that we all went over this morning with the architects, and it clearly shows that it would be extremely challenging, if not impossible, to plant it on the southwest corner. So I don't know what that language needs to how that needs to read, but we need some flexibility and latitude in designing that deck and placing it on the south side of that parcel.
Possibly with the architects, the flexibility that they need.
And I've got that. It's in schematic design.
How can we word that, Councilor?
Well, why don't you go sit down with the mayor first and make sure he understands it before
you go over it? We can do this and have to go sit down. Yeah. We need to get on this parking deck because it's kind of holding everything.
Can you word it just the
And we can't lock in a price or do anything until we get this locked down, can we?
Yes, that's correct.
Councilor's working vigorously away. We had a word form. Computer, he's just changing it.
They can type pretty fast, you know.
Really, we want it just to be that this is agreeable contingent upon approval in accordance to the architect. The architectural design.
South half of the parking lot, let him have his flexibility, what he needs.
What if we were to put, the right language reads now, one parking facility with no less than 220 parking spaces on a 2.69-acre parcel located at the southwest corner of Kent Highway and Castleberry Road, tax parcel C16087, with such modifications to placement and configuration as are reasonably necessary to accommodate a parking facility with 220 parking spaces. With such modification to placement and configuration as are reasonably necessary.
Are you going to give the architect the authority to make that decision?
Well, what we need to do is have Doug go sit down with Ford and Gerald Warren and talk about this. Show him, take Joe Lee, show him what needs to be placed on there.
Yeah. I can do that. I understand the urgency. This is on a critical path, and that would certainly give me enough to go over and speak to them again.
Would it be helpful if it was with such modifications to placement and configuration as are reasonably necessary in the discretion of the architect, to put that in there, to put a particular person that has to determine what's necessary?
Within the southern half of the parking area.
Or
say within the southern half, right.
But I like the discretion of the architect, just because you're tying it to somebody. Right.
The best knows.
It may be a non-issue with the city. I would rather have the discretion with the architect's assistance to place it in the most appropriate place on the south south end of that parcel.
Okay.
If you tie it down any more than that, it's probably going to be a smaller footprint, much smaller footprint, maybe a higher, taller facility, which may be some additional costs associated with it, and there may not be the access we need again for not just entry and exit for public and proper traffic flow, but perhaps also for emergency vehicles.
I really think Ford is meant for it to be Mayor Groby.
On the south end?
South end, close to that corner.
The best you can deal with it, but yeah, you're probably agree with that.
You got a word in Parks Council?
How about this, Doug? So it's a one parking facility with no less than 220 spaces on a 2.69 acre parcel of city property located on the southern portion of tax parcel C16087, with such placement and configuration as determined by the county's architect to accommodate a parking facility with 220 parking.
I'm much more comfortable with it.
I have one more.
Sorry.
2B. Maybe it's just confusing, or maybe it does. It says that the city shall be entitled to the remaining city shares of Splot 7 to be given in exchange. My concern is, do we need to say, and the county shall be entitled to the remaining county share to be exchanged? Is there something special about the city shall be entitled to the remaining city share? Who would have questioned that?
No. The problem is, if they don't do away, if we don't designate, if they don't give us that entire money, and we can give it back to them, but that covers them from having any more funds in that parking deck expense. There's a clause in there that says this money collected will go to the parking deck, correct? And so by us swapping funds, it takes it off their books.
I think what Commissioner Boff has identified is actually that word is supposed to be county.
That's what I thought.
Parties further agreed that following the disbursement of $5.3 million to the county shall then be entitled to the remaining city share of SPLOS 6 collections to be given dollar for dollar exchange with the county from their park and rec fund to be used by the city for improvement.
Yeah.
So that has to be changed.
You're getting good.
After wait, I said that,
that was funny.
Here, let me threaten you now.
We have to yell for it.
Yeah.
Let's leave that part out.
It's different.
Well, in fact, I mean, there's a couple of areas I'd like to make that particular paragraph a little more clear. I understand what the city had in mind but there's a couple of words that may have been, I understand exactly what the intent is to give this dollar for dollar exchange.
Okay. Any other questions? Now, how do we make a motion, Ken, that can say if they approve it, it'll be approved by us? How do you think the motion to stay?
I just want to see. Did you have anything else?
No.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, I think that if the board is inclined to approve this on a time-sensitive basis as a formal offer, which is what this would be, an offer to the City of Cumming by way of this contract, you could approve the contract in your agenda books with the modifications that on paragraph 2B, the second line, the word city, the first reference to city, shall be changed to county. And then on 2C, the sub-statement 1, one parking facility with no less than 220 parking spaces on a 2.69 acre parcel of city property, the Castleberry property located on the southern portion of tax parcel C16087 with such placement and configuration, as determined by the county's architect, to accommodate a parking facility with 220 parking spaces. That would be your motion.
How about up to 200?
I think the deal's 220, 250.
With at least 220.
Yeah.
The minimum.
Okay.
I will tell you today, and that's a good point, Commissioner, but today, as designed, it's exactly 220. But it may vary a little bit in design and placement.
I'll make a motion that we accept the IGA as time-sensitive matter as stated by our council, with minor changes made, and it, once the city approves it, it shall be approved, or?
It shall be proposed to the city as a binding contract.
Is this time-sensitive?
Yes, I said time-sensitive.
Okay, second time-sensitive.
Any other discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 4-0. Thank you. Council, is there a need for executive session for litigation, land acquisition, and personnel?
Mr. Chairman, there is, please.
Is there a motion to recess the work session?
So moved.
Second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Mr. Chairman, forgive me for that. Can we have a formal motion to go into executive session for the purpose of?
You're so picky sometimes. Every we got a motion. Well, do we need to undo our recess? Make a motion and dissolve our recess motion. All in favor? Signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Now, your motion to go into executive session. First, litigation, land acquisition, and our personnel.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? 4-0. Commissioner Tam being absent. Thank you. Now is a motion to recess.
So moved.
Second.
A motion to second recess. All in favor? Think about saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? 4-0. Here, Commissioner Tam is absent. We reconvene at 3:40.
Hey, Les, how are you doing?
Good.
Good to see you.
Good seeing you. Good.
Yeah.
I was off and on. Because he's been going out of town for the next few weeks, so I just.
Yeah.
Yeah.